as great as its King. And we serve an awesome King. Amen? Yes. Yes. Today is Palm Sunday. Do you know what that means? That means that 1 week from today is Resurrection Sunday. He got up. You understand? He got up, which is why we're here, because if he was still in that grave, I don't know about you, but I wouldn't be here. We serve a mighty God, a mighty King who rules an awesome kingdom. I want to talk about what's going to be going on and something we're going to be doing next Sunday, but something happened this morning already. Several churches in Egypt came together to celebrate the Palm Sunday and prepare for the day of resurrection of our Lord and Savior, and a lot of people lost their lives in two attacks on churches so far today. It looks like some coordinated events. I want to remember those are our brothers and sisters, and those are believers. They knew that going to their church today made them a big target, but they counted the cost. They showed up, and it cost them their lives. Let's pray for them. Father God of glory, you are great and your kingdom is great. You said, Jesus, if my kingdom was of this world, I would fight and my servants would fight. And we know the day will come, Messiah, when you return, you make all things right. For this moment, we're here in this earth as lambs, as sheep. I ask you, Father, to give great grace to those who have been attacked and hurt, for the families of those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. And God, I pray at any cost that your gospel, your word, your truth would go forth, Father, in those areas like never before as a result of the blood of those martyrs, those men, those women, and those children. Father, bring comfort, please, in this moment, in Jesus' name. Amen. God's been rolling something around in the heart of Pastor Dan for a few weeks now. I was talking to him the other day, and he's got a page full of notes and things that God has put on his heart. And sometimes it's kind of difficult in the middle of the hustle and bustle to kind of order those thoughts. But I believe that God has given him something that's going to be absolutely amazing. How many know that there are few opportunities in the year to get your loved ones and to get people to church? But Easter is one of those that people expect to be invited. If you don't invite them, I'm telling you, you're going to disappoint them. We call them CEOs, Christmas and Easter onlys. But it's okay. We've made up these cards, and I want you to believe with me, and these are waiting at the Welcome Center here and the one as you leave the door, but I want you to agree with me as you take these cards, and please take some of these to your work. Take these to wherever you go and whatever you do, gas station, grocery store, hand them out, and believe with me that every man, woman, and child that comes in here and hears the message that God is preparing in the heart of Pastor Dan for Easter, for Resurrection Day, that they will be touched and the power of the Holy Spirit will move in a mighty way. The Holy Spirit will convict of sin, righteousness, and judgment to the salvation of many. Will you agree with me on that? So please, these cards, it's called Soul Currency, and he's going to explain this. He's going to make it very clear. It's going to be really neat to watch and to see. If this is your first time, or you're new, or you haven't been a part of Rockfish in the past, we're in the middle of a series. In fact, this is the second installment. It's called Earthly Hotel. And I know that may sound a little different, but it's speaking of, in fact, I'm going to elaborate on that in a few minutes. In fact, there's a verse that I want to read that I believe really kind of exemplifies it. This is not the text verse for the series, but this is something God laid on my heart. The book of Ecclesiastes 3:11 says this, and feel this. Not that I'm big on feelings. I believe we walk by faith, not by feelings, but at the same time, just experience what this does as I read this. It says, he has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I remember in one of the last conversations that I had with my grandmother, we were actually celebrating a birthday. I'm not sure. She was 80-something. She was getting up there. And she was sitting in this, I want to say it was a wheelchair. It may have just been a regular chair. But I'll never forget her trying to express something that God has put in the heart of every human being, which is eternity. We know we were designed, we were created, and something inside of us tells us that there is more to this than now. And she sat in that chair and she said, Tony, I'll never forget this conversation. She had these beautiful blue eyes, and I peered into her eyes and I saw, she said, my body is wrecked and it's old. And she had been through operation after operation. She had suffered a lot of things physically and in her body. She said, Tony, look at my eyes. You don't see me. She said, I am in here. I am that 17, 18-year-old girl. I am just as alive. My mind is just as vibrant. My soul is just as alive as it was when I was 16 or 17, even though I'm trapped in this body. And I watched as she tried to contextualize 80-plus years of life and to contextualize it compared to eternity as just a fleeting moment. As she said, yesterday I was this little girl. Never forget that conversation. I knew at that moment that eternity is truly locked and been placed in the heart of humanity. And it's just so sobering. This is what Jesus did. John 8:23 is actually our text verse for this series. I want to read that. It says, but, and this is Jesus speaking, it says, but he continued, you are from below. I am from above. He's drawing a contrast. You are of this world. I am not of this world. And here's what Jesus did, in case you don't realize it, is he stepped out of eternity and into time. And with truth and love, he began to change the gaze of humanity. He lifted the chin of humanity from the fleeting temporal to the forever. Over and over and over, he pointed man from looking at this, which is fleeting and temporary, to focusing on the eternal, and that was a great part of his message. Christ's life exemplifies prioritizing the eternal over the temporal. Why? Because every single one of us, when we were born, we were given, think about it this way, you were given a visa. And every one of us hold a visa today, and that visa has a day of expiration. He knew that. He knew the fleeting of the moment and begged us to focus on the lasting forever. Jesus operated with a certain attitude, an attitude concerning this life that very often is different than what our attitude is, vastly different. In fact, everything he did, and just think about it this way, and you can look through the Gospels. I read through the four Gospels recently, and I started back over and read several of them. Everything he did and everything he spoke and everything he shared was in preparation for his exit. Jesus wasn't here building a kingdom. He wasn't here building his life and carrying out his agenda. He was here on mission. He was here on purpose because he understood the minuteness of the moment that he had to leave an impression on time. And he made the absolute most of it. And encouraged his disciples, his followers of that day, as I encourage you to do the same, to make the most of the moments that we've been given. And here's what we need to know. Christ knew this. Our sacrifice of the present shows our value of the promise. It's powerful. Our sacrifice of the present shows our value of the promise. I think there's a story that exemplifies this in the Bible that illustrates this as a life lesson for all of us. And I want to go over it. I call it the plan, the plow, and the purpose. It's 1 Kings 19, 19 through 21. And a lot of you have heard this. A lot of you understand and have heard this story. I'm going to teach a little bit differently this morning. It's going to be a little bit more expository as I go through. I'm going to read it, then I'm going to go through it and kind of break it down. But my prayer is that in the middle of this, in fact, Jesus, help us. Help us to hear this and it not just be a story, but be an application. Touch each individual and show us, God, where this can change us to a greater likeness of Jesus. Amen. Let me set the scene. Elijah, I'm dealing with two characters here, Elisha and Elijah, but Elijah was one of the absolute greatest prophets of this time to this point. I mean, this was a powerful man. He was no joke. He did some amazing things. You can read about it in 1 and 2 Kings, what he did. But at this point, where we find this happening, Elijah had just had a confrontation with the prophets of Baal, which was the pagans of that day, under the instruction of the queen Jezebel, who was manipulating her husband and vicariously running the kingdom. Anyway, he had challenged them. He had had an incredible success. God had shown up on his behalf, and he had kicked some booty there, if that's appropriate. And it was off of this great victory that immediately following it, Jezebel said, I am going to dedicate my life to punishing you for this and killing you and making you pay. So after this incredible cultural clash, he runs. He falls into deep depression, and he's hiding in a cave at the threat of this woman, and he's kind of complaining to God. He goes, God, I'm the only one left. There's nobody. Do you ever feel that way sometimes? Do you ever feel like this world has lost its mind? Are there any authentic Christians out there anyway? Am I the only one that loves God? Maybe you feel that way. Maybe at times you wonder, are you the only one? Well, he was in a deep state of depression at that point. He said, God, I am the last one. And God said, no, man. He said, you're not the last one. He said, I have reserved 7,000 people who have not bowed their knee to this culture, who've said, I will not submit to the values of this and will not bow my knee to that. And he said, he gave him some instructions. And again, read it, because there's a lot of details that I'm leaving out. God showed up and revealed himself to this man in an amazing way. But that's not what I want to focus on. He said, I want you to do a couple things. One, I want you to realize that I'm going to make things right. He said, there has been some injustices, and this person's going to take care of it. And if this person doesn't, then this person will. And so he gave him peace about justice being served. And then he said, I want you to find a particular man, and I want you to give him or anoint him as the prophet to take your place. This is big. This is heavy. This is the preeminent prophet. Again, he said, I want you to find him. This is where we pick up our story. 1 Kings 19:19-21. So Elijah went from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat, and he was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen, and he himself was driving the 12th pair. Elijah went up to him, and he threw his cloak around him, and Elijah then left his oxen and ran after Elijah. Let me kiss my father and my mother goodbye, he said, and then I will come with you. Go back, Elijah replied. What have I done to you? So Elisha left him and went back and took his yoke of oxen and slaughtered them and burned the plowing equipment to cook the meat and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he set out to follow Elijah and became his servant. I believe there are five elements in here that will really help us not focus on the temporal but turn our gaze like never before to the eternal. I believe that we need this in this day and hour. I believe that this is something, a level of surrender and dedication that God is calling for his people to walk in that maybe we've not walked in before. The first aspect of it is I believe he's calling us to be faithful stewards. Let me break this open. It says, so Elijah went from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat, and he was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen, and he himself was driving the 12th pair. Have you ever wondered if God knew where you were? This man is minding his own business. He's plowing in a field. He's driving his oxen. He's doing very normal, very what would be considered mundane work. I have wondered, God, do you know where I am? I remember 20 years actually, I worked in another job, and I tried to serve and honor and be the best steward that I could be with what I had been given at that time, and to follow God in a way that was pleasing to God. But I wondered, God, do you really know where I'm at? Can you find me if you need to? Because, you know, sometimes you wonder, am I doing something to keep God from finding me? I want to say this. It's not about where you are. It's about who you are. I want you to understand something. When he found Elisha, he wasn't reading his Bible, and he wasn't in a church, and he wasn't in a seminary. He was plowing. Now, I want you to ask yourself this question. How must this man have lived? What must he have done in order to be chosen by God to replace the preeminent prophet of the day? Now think about this and realize that whatever it was that he had done, he did in the context of the family and the farm. Let that sink in for just a minute, because this will mess up your theology. This will mess up kind of maybe your plans. Maybe it'll mess up your purpose and how you do things. He pleased God in the context of the family and the farm. What does that prove? It means that his stewardship of the mundane marked him by God for the miraculous. It is easy, very easy for us to fall into a place of despising our current present. And in doing so, if we walk despising where we are forsaking the future that God has for us. This man was pleasing to God in the context of the family and the farm. And we look in the New Testament and we see any leader in the church is qualified. Why? Because he manages his home. Because he is above reproach and above accusation in the business world or in the world of relationships. You see, it's the same qualifiers. It's not going to seminary, reading the Bible, or attending church. God is looking for those, again, who are faithful in the mundane that he might mark us for the miraculous. And that's what he did. This should inspire every one of us to be stewards like never before, knowing that God knows where we are. He's measuring us by how we are. I want to say this, and I don't want you to get mad at me. But if you despise your present condition, I want you to ask yourself this question. Is it because of where I am or because of who I am? I just want us to be sober. If I despise where I am, is it because of my conditions or is it because of who I am? Is it my perspective? Because one is guaranteed to change the condition, but you can take a bad perspective into great conditions and you can blow that thing up, and you don't want to do that. So again, the question would be, is the stewardship of your mundane marking you for the miraculous? Second point, I think we need to embrace our identity. I talked about having an identity a couple of weeks ago and the importance of knowing your identity, but there comes a where the rubber hits the road aspect. Your identity, does who you are and what you are in Christ, does it show up in your life? If it doesn't, you haven't embraced the identity that you've been given, or maybe who you say you are is not who you really are. He said, so Elijah went up from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat. He was plowing with the 12 yoke of oxen, and he himself was driving the 12 pair, and Elijah went up to him and threw his cloak around him. Here's what I want you to see. It says he went up to him. He left the beaten path. Elijah went out of his way, and he went to where he was in the middle of what he was doing, and he walked up to him, and he threw his cloak on him. And you ask, well, what does that show? One, it was an anointing of the prophet. It was an anointing or a transfer or a change of his position, but it was something else. In that culture, it was the final element of adoption. So you got to understand something about identity. His name, the name of his father was Shaphat. Do you know what that means? It means execution of judgment. Do you know what Elijah means? Jehovah is God. He threw that cloak around him and changed him from being a son or an object of wrath to a son of God. When we put on Christ, when we are adopted into him, our identity changes. He erased who he was. He changed it through adoption, represented by that cloak. His identity changed that day in that moment. And here's something I think we need to realize. Some of us already have, and to what degree I think it needs to be ever growing. We are not who we were. We are not who we were. I don't want to mess this up, but who you are is affected very, very greatly by whose you are. We're God's. I don't mean we're God's. I mean we're his. His children, his adopted. He has thrown the cloak of his love around us. And have we fully embraced? And how do we fully embrace that? Because if you understand and embrace your identity, it will change your behavior. It will change your attitude as well as your potential. He made an exchange right there, and Elisha accepted that exchange. He changed his identity, but it had to be complete. brings us to the second part. There's a cost that comes when you fully embrace the identity that God has given you. When you step up to walk in your call, the one that God has offered in the person of Jesus Christ. It says, then Elisha left his oxen and ran after Elijah. Guys, it took him a minute. Don't you think about this? It says he left his oxen and he ran. Now, you know it took him a minute because if he did it and he walked it there, he wouldn't have to run. Something happened in that minute. Something happened, and however long it took him to cause him to have to run, he counted the cost. See, something you got to understand about Elisha. Listen to what he says when he gets there. He said, let me kiss my father and my mother goodbye, and then I will come with you. Go back, Elijah replied. What have I done to you? He said, let me kiss. This guy didn't come from a broken home. See, it's one thing for us to give up bad stuff. It's one thing for you to give up your hangovers and your busted relationship. That's one thing. But he came from a good home. He said, let me kiss my father and my mother. Not my mother and my father. This guy had something rare and beautiful. He had a good relationship with his dad. That is powerful. And listen, he was plowing behind 12 yoke of oxen. He didn't have 24 oxen in front of him with one plow. He was on the 12th yoke. He was on the 12th pair. There were 11 other pairs or yokes of oxen being driven by servants at that point. This man didn't come from abject poverty. He was giving up the ability to have and get wealth in the natural. He had some decisions to make, and he's going, it's going to cost me. Jesus said it this way, if you love your mother or your father or your children, or your houses or home or land or even your life more than you love me, you're not worthy of me. And in that moment, he was counting the cost of what it meant to become a disciple of this man. He knew that to embrace that identity meant that he had a counter cost because things would never be the same. And which helps us really understand what Elijah meant when he said this. This verse has always perplexed me. He said, what? He said, go back. What have I done to you? See, Elijah knew something about the call. He understood the call, he understood the honor, and he understood the price. See, some think to follow Christ will not cost you anything. I'm here to tell you the truth is to follow Christ will cost you everything. I surrender all. I was listening to that song thinking, you know what, that's the truth. That's the truth. It'll cost you relationships. It'll cost you worldviews. It'll cost you attitudes. It'll cost you political opinions and opinions. To follow Christ will cost you. Elijah was here in this moment with Elisha, knowing full well that following God would put him on a collision course with culture, just like it had him. And the most recent memory was him cowering in fear and defeat in a cave as a result of following and doing what God had called him to do. His life being threatened and him hiding. Yet in the middle of that call, something happened. God revealed himself to him like never before. So he understood the cost, but he also understood the glory that comes when we walk with God in the call, and his presence is more powerful than any problem that we might face. Whew, that's where I want to be. I don't mind being in the storm if I'm in that storm with the power of the Spirit. See, God calls us sometimes, like he did these men, to take light into very dark places, and that has a price tag. I said that to say this, that cowardice has no place in the kingdom. There is no place for cowardice in the kingdom. See, that sounds harsh. That's actually in the Bible. It says no coward. We've not been called to an easy road. We've been called to an impossible road, one that requires us to count the cost soberly and intentionally. Number four, I like this one. This is the most difficult. Burn the plow. It says, so Elisha left him and went back. He took his yoke of oxen and he slaughtered them, and he burned the plowing equipment to cook the meat and gave it to the people, and they ate. Listen, I want you to catch this. Any sacrifice that you make for God multiplies what you can do for others. Now listen, he sacrificed his oxen, or he killed his oxen, he cooked them, and he fed those around him. When you make the sacrifices in the temporal, in the present. The sacrifices of the present show the value of the promise. When you make those sacrifices in this present, it not only opens you up to receive from God, but it creates an ability for others to come and feast on your sacrifice. He said, come on, come and dine. Jesus said it this way. He said, the kingdom of God is like a little mustard seed. Smallest of all seeds, but when it's planted, it grows up and becomes the greatest of herbs. And all the fowls of the air come and rest in its branches. If you will dare, Jesus said it this way to the disciples. He said, well, it's harder for a rich man to go to heaven than it is for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle. And he said, well, who can be saved? He said, we've given up everything. We've given up houses. And Jesus said it. He said, any man that gives up houses and homes and lands and all of this for my sake and the kingdom's sake will receive in this life a hundredfold and then eternal life. He was saying, your sacrifice in this life is multiplied through the lives of others. There has to come a killing of the cow and a burning of the plow. And this is kind of the attitude that has to happen. In 1519, some of you know this and heard this story. Captain Hernan Cortez landed in Veracruz to begin his great conquest of the Aztec people. 600 men. Upon arriving, he gave the orders to the men to burn the ships. Now, I want you to catch something here. This is not what you think. He didn't get off the shore, get up there, and surprisingly set the ships on fire. He spent days on that beach, sharing with them, painting them the picture and the vision of what the ultimate conquest and the goal would look like. He came into a place of unity with those 600 men on that beach. And they agreed, burn the ships. There is no surrender. There will be no retreat. And 600 men conquered the Aztec nation. Why? Because they didn't have a plan B. We are not called to have a plan B. We accomplish what we accomplish, and we love not our lives unto death. This is not just theory. This is a reality. We cannot be tethered to this world, cannot be too connected to the now and fully engage the eternal. He wasn't the only one that did this, just so you know. Alexander the Great burned his boats upon arriving on the shores of Persia. Alexander the Great conquered the known world by the time he was, 27, 24? By burning his boats, Alexander committed his men to victory over the Persians, who far outnumbered the Greeks in great numbers. I believe God is looking for men and women who are willing to burn the plow, to burn their plans, to burn the ability that they have to get wealth, to burn our provision and lean heavily on what God can do in spite of us, not because of us, and walk in something greater. I believe this. Will we do it? Will we be that generation? Will we be the ones who stop focusing to the detriment of tomorrow on today? Little people think about little things. God calls us to things that are so much greater than we are. And if we're not walking in the power of who He is, embracing our identity and what He can do in spite of us, not because of us, we'll never embrace what God has called us to. Burn the plows. Kill the oxen. Burning our allegiance to this world and its ways is the first response to following Christ. I got to say this, guys. You don't try Jesus. Jesus didn't try the cross. He embraced it with everything He was for our sakes. And He turns around and says, now embrace everything that I am for the world's sake. Modeling for us like no man ever, sacrifice. Talking to His disciples before He went to the cross, saying, it's not the same with you as it is with the world. We lay down our lives for others, not save our life at every cost. See, when you take away fear of death, you create something that becomes unmanageable in this world. And that's what Christians have always been. We have always been unmanageable. We've never bowed our knee to Caesar. We've never bowed our knee to culture. We've never compromised because of outward pressure, because there was an inner greater power. The kingdom of God is greater. Yeah, it's not something that we see today, but by faith in the promise, we know tomorrow we will. And the King is returning to establish His kingdom. Our conduct in the mundane marks us for the miraculous. In Christ, truly, there is no surrender, no retreat. Embrace the mantle. This is the last part. It says, 1 Kings, it says, he set out to follow Elijah and became his servant. He removed everything that inhibited or interfered with total dedication to Elijah. The final element was and is the embrace of the message. So the question becomes, who will carry the call? You cannot carry the call and push the plow. Can't carry the call with your agenda. It falls short. It gets squeezed out like vines, like thorns, the cares of this world. I'm going to be teaching on this in a couple weeks. You cannot be engaged in active duty, worried about paying our light bills. We got to know that the promise says this: seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and he will add everything that the pagans seek to find fulfillment in to us. Not because of us, but because of who he is and his identity that he has bestowed upon us as sons and daughters of the living God. My heart beats heavy to be everything that he's called me to be. For you to be everything he's called you to be, to embrace our identities. But only the faithful, only the sober, only the committed children of God. So the question is, will you kill your cows and burn your plows? I said it that way because it rhymed, but isn't it neat? Will you kill your cows? And listen, your cows and your plows are all different, but I trust the Holy Spirit is speaking to you. I know this can seem somewhat abstract, but I believe that the Holy Spirit sometimes even supersedes our understanding, and he knows where you are so well that he can reach in and touch in places that I can't through the frailty of a speech or a preaching. So if the Holy Spirit has touched a cow, again, the cow and the plow represents our ability sometimes and our plans. But will you burn your plans for him? Will you forsake your ability for his ability? And will we exchange our identity for his purpose? It's always been the question. And the model has been presented in the Old Testament and the New Testament. And we present that model through our very lives to a lost and dying world so that they might have hope, not in the present, but in the promise. And this week as we go out and we recognize that we're going to celebrate that promise, Christ got up. He's not there. If he's there, we shouldn't be here. We have a promise, the hope that we will live for eternity in eternity. This is our hope. I'm not going to circle. I'm not going to go around this again, but stand if you can, if you're able, and let's pray and we'll get out of here. I mentioned this a couple weeks ago that scientists were worried about the tomb of Christ collapsing. I remember saying, he's not there. It's okay. It's not detrimental to the Christian faith if his tomb collapses. Or if I ever see the hole into which his cross was placed, I know my Savior. He's not a theory. He's a friend, a father, a brother. At times, as strange as it might sound, a mother who loves and nurtures us as his very own. Father, I would just ask that as we go soberly, assessing your call and counting the cost, burning, Father God, the plow, killing the cows that are necessary. Father, any idols, anything that we've substituted for you, Father, I ask you to draw us to that place of commitment, the place that we need to be in order for this world to hear the good news of the gospel like never before. Create a boldness and a fire and a hunger for you like we've never had, please. In Jesus' name.